Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will take evidence on the COVID-19 Communication of Public Health Information Inquiry. We have two panels today and I'd like to welcome our first panel to the meeting who are appearing virtually. Callum Hood, Head of Research for the Centre of Countering Digital Hate. Will Moy, Chief Executive of Full Fact. Dr. Dawn Holford, Senior Research Associate for Cyber, and Tracy Brown, OBE, Director of Sense and Science. Thank you very much for giving us your time this morning. The session will be the first of the committee's evidence sessions on the inquiry. There will be a further session on the 23rd of June before we hear from the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport on the 30th of June. Each member will have approximately 10 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you would like to respond to an issue being discussed, please put R in the chat box and we'll try and bring you in. Can I invite the witnesses just to introduce yourself? Can we start with Callum, please?
Hi, good morning. It's great to be invited to speak to you today. I'm Callum Hood. I'm the Head of Research at the Centre for Countering Digital Hate. We are a CCDH, is a US non-profit, 501c3, based in Washington DC, and CCDH UK is a non-profit based in the UK as well. So we're an international organisation that looks at countering hate and disinformation by disrupting the online architecture that enables its growth, and we've done a lot of work on COVID and anti-vax during the pandemic.
Thank you very much, Callum. Can I bring in Will?
Thank you. My name is Will Moy. I run a charity called Full Fact. As we all know, bad information can ruin lives, can damage people's health, it can promote hate, and it can hurt democracy. Full Fact tries to understand how bad information comes from, provides fact-checking for millions of people to make up their own minds about key topics, and tries to understand how we can make systems changes to reduce the harm done by bad information.
Thank you, Will. Can I bring in Dr. Dawn?
Hi, my name is Dawn Holford and I am a coordinating leader of SciBe, which is an independent initiative led by academic researchers. And in the past 2 years, SciBe has been actively looking at the landscape of science and public health communication and the challenges that it's faced during the pandemic. And just how can we better link up scientific community by better evidence for policymaking.
That's great. Thanks very much. And Tracy?
Hi, I'm the director of Sense About Science. We are a charity that promotes public interest in sound science and evidence. We work with communities all over the UK to make sense of science and with researchers and policymakers to create an environment in which research is discussed openly and with appreciation of uncertainty. We have 20 years of experience of helping people navigate some of the most complex and controversial areas of evidence and policy making.
Thank you very much. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Firstly, can I ask the panel to define misinformation and disinformation? And can the panel give examples of misinformation and disinformation that spread during the pandemic? And Tracy, can I bring you through? Because I know that in your report you do highlight this.
Yeah, thank you. So our report you referred to is a scoping inquiry into how well the government's evidence for COVID-19 decisions serve society. Misinformation is something that people, and I think actually Will's probably better at this, but misinformation is something that people attain through trying to make sense of the world, and disinformation is an active attempt to give people wrong information. I would actually draw attention to lack of information in many cases. I find it rather strange that the focus in a way has been looking at some of the more fringe discussions that there have been around things like vaccination and so on, when people were actually knocking at the door of the UK government and also devolved administration governments to try and get more information. And I don't think they were very well served in a lot of cases around the areas of risk and understanding of the magnitude of effect of different interventions. So, you know, there's a kind of other category, if you like, which is just a vacuum of information into which other things get sucked. And that tends to draw in both misinformation and disinformation.
Thank you very much. Will, can I bring you in?
So the sort of standard distinction between misinformation and disinformation, and misinformation is consumed and spread inadvertently, and disinformation is in some way deliberate. But it's important to say that the same piece of content could be therefore both misinformation and disinformation. You could have false information deliberately seeded into public debate, but then shared by people who are genuinely trying to help their friends and family and genuinely believe it. And in that context, you'd call it misinformation. So I'd suggest that Tracy's attention to information quality more widely is a really helpful thing to think about here. We talk about the unlikely journey of good information. I think at this stage in the COVID process, and I should say I'm very grateful for this inquiry, I think you're doing a very important task. We're all familiar with the reverse Swiss cheese model of risk prevention, which is to say that no one set of protections eliminates all risk. Every set of protections has some hole in it. And so in order to avoid risk, you have a whole series of layers of protections that collectively stop the holes from going all the way through the system. But good information works differently. A lot of things have to go right in sequence for people to end up being well informed. Firstly, we have to collect good data. Then we have to do good analysis on it. Then we have to communicate that analysis to people who can reach large audiences. They have to understand it, communicate it effectively, and then it has to be understood and used by people making decisions in their own lives or in policy contexts or whatever. And every stage of that process can fail. So to talk about misinformation just about as the content at the end of that long process can sometimes obscure the root causes of how misinformation and disinformation comes to harm to people's health.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. Can I just ask, during the height of the pandemic, when COVID was dominating the news and all government business, do you think that there was a case of information overload where people either could not keep up or did not want to keep up? And if that's the case, do you think sometimes that too much information can be unhelpful? I'm open to whoever wants to take that question, if you just want to raise your hand. Tracy?
It's actually the kind of information that people wanted. So what we found was that there was a really, there was an underestimation of the extent to which policies required people to make trade-offs in their lives against other risks and benefits that they needed to think about. So to give you an example, one of the people we spoke to was a bus driver in rural services, who had to make the decision about whether to let a teenager on the bus without a mask. And they needed some sense of the order of magnitude of that risk in order to determine whether it was sufficient to leave a child standing on a lonely rural road with no pavement and not pick them up. The people were making quite significant decisions in their lives. They aren't just deciding about, you know, what they think sat at home. Lots of people were out deciding whether their employees were safe. They were deciding whether to have health visitor services to families in crisis and child protection services and things like this, and trying to weigh those kinds of risks. So I think in that area, there was a real trouble that people had with getting at the thinking behind government decision making and trying to understand the relationship between the evidence and so on. There was a lot of going on, obviously, in terms of, you know, things being found out. There was a huge stream of information coming, not just from people's own governments and scientists and so on, but internationally. You know, there was a 24/7 hunger for COVID news and casting around the world, and, you know, people were watching what was going on in terms of case rises in Germany or the USA, India, and so on. So there was a feeling, I think, that people had of being overwhelmed with COVID stuff, but not necessarily the enabling information they needed in making decisions in their lives. We found quite a drop off. So we had run a survey with NatCen Social Research, looking at what people's experienced in the first 6 months of the pandemic, and then in the early part of 2021. And there was quite a drop-off between the numbers of people, you know, looking for information each day, but not that significant, interestingly. It went from somewhere up in the 90s, I think it was about 93% or something, were looking once a week or more for information on government policies, and it dropped down to something like 76%. A year later, we expected a bigger drop-off. But the numbers searching every single day or more than once a day really dropped. Though there was a sort of fatigue apparent there. But I do think that the crucial bit is that people have told us in many, many settings that they were missing the key information they needed to make good decisions.
Thank you, Tracy. Will Moy, I know that you'd like to come in.
Yeah, just to build on what Tracy said, I completely agree with that analysis. Firstly, there was a huge appetite for reliable, trustworthy information. Full facts, or more people coming to our work than ever before. We also saw the first increase in use of traditional media like TV that we've seen year on year for a very long time. At the same time, people were failing to get information directly useful to them, and I can give you two examples of that. One is that early on in the pandemic, we launched a service called Ask Full Facts, where we ask people for what questions you have. We got over 2,000 questions in a few weeks, and 40% of them were about what does the guidance mean, how does it apply to me, what can I actually do, what do I do in this situation? And some of them were genuinely heartbreaking practical questions. I have someone I care for who's on the other side of the border. Am I allowed to go there and help them get their medicine or not? They're really practical, life-changing situations. That kind of demand was there. The other side, where I think there was a real unmet demand for good information, was in certain particular groups and situations. And one was around people who were pregnant, women who were pregnant or trying to get pregnant, who were subject to constantly changing guidance and science, which became very confusing. So we ended up actually working with a charity called Pregnant Then Screwed, which advocates the rights of people who are pregnant and against discrimination, and set up a WhatsApp helpline where people could text their questions to us. And the appetite for that, again, was huge, just because although there had been lots of guidance and so much information out there, it hadn't actually spoken to people in a consistent way in that situation who were starting families, and particularly women who were actually pregnant and trying to make choices about, for example, getting the vaccine when they're pregnant or when they're breastfeeding or when they're trying to get pregnant.
Thank you very much. Yep, I remember that, the hesitancy from the ladies that were pregnant and trying to get pregnant during that time with the vaccinations. Can I move on to Murdo?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Good morning, panel. I think all the parliamentarians here will have had experience over the past 2 years of constituents writing in, expressing views, saying, you know, COVID is a hoax. Is all a conspiracy by the government. Vaccinations are there to try and control the population, and usually linking to, you know, articles in obscure corners of the internet backing up their argument. Maybe I could ask this first to Dr. Dawn Holford, because it's covered a bit in the paper you submitted. What is the motivation for those who are actively spreading disinformation on the internet that people are picking up on?
So I think this is probably also related to Callum, because we cite his work as well, but we do see examples of people wanting to actually make political or personal gain for presenting disinformation. For a lot of disinformation around, for example, fake cure, saying that COVID is not so bad, you can cure it with turmeric or natural homeopathy, usually are wanting people to turn to them for help as well. And also, basically, we also have evidence that there are political actors, international actors who have interest in sowing distrust in effective Western vaccines. For example, it has been shown that the Sputnik Twitter account was deliberately spreading misinformation about the side effects experienced of other vaccines. So we are actually facing coordinated campaigns that are aiming to mislead people. And it may be a destabilization motive here, but there's a lot of different motives of the actors.
Okay, thank you. I think Callum Hood, you wanted to come in.
Thanks, yeah.
Oh, we can't hear you.
Oh dear.
No, we can hear you now, that's okay.
Okay, wonderful. So Just to pick, I mean, Dawn mentioned this, but when it comes to disinformation, there are some very influential individuals around the world whose motivation is primarily financial. They typically come from the sort of alternative health industry, and they have a product, Dell, and they sell that product with what's sometimes been called sort of health or medical populism. So they tell you that you can't trust your doctor, you can't trust the NHS or whichever public health body it is in your the country that you live in, and that you should trust them instead, and that there's an easy solution, and it's to purchase some sort of supplement or to follow some sort of advice that they offer. We did a report called Pandemic Profiteers that looked at 12 such individuals, and they had annual revenues of around $36 million, and this is $36 million. And this is people like Joseph McCullough, who's an alternative health entrepreneur, runs the most popular alternative health website in the world, and people like Andrew Wakefield, who we know well in the UK, who's turned his scepticism about vaccines into somewhat of a business in the US as well. So that's disinformation. And then when it comes to misinformation, it sort of relates to the previous question about information overload and so on. Ordinary people trying to make sense of all this. As all of us experienced, there are big information gaps that we had, and there was a lot of anxiety about how dangerous is COVID, when will vaccines come, you know, how safe are they, how can I avoid getting COVID, and how dangerous will it be to me? And so a lot of the misinformation spread was a result of people trying to grapple with those anxieties and uncertainties, and was often informed by the disinformation, I think this is something Will mentioned, informed by the disinformation spread by more organised, determined and organised individuals like those I've just described.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that. So, I mean, my second question follows on then from what you've just said, because you had that one group of people who were basically saying, you know, COVID's a hoax, don't believe it. There was another group of people who took perhaps a slightly more rational view, which was that we accept COVID as a problem, but we're nervous about being vaccinated because these vaccines have only just been invented. We don't know what the long-term consequences would be. The convener was mentioning earlier the issue with pregnant women being concerned about taking the vaccine. I suppose my question, therefore, is where the public health messages being put out across the UK sufficient to try and reassure people who were concerned about vaccinations, and to what extent were those messages being undermined by misinformation on the internet and elsewhere? Who would like to pick that up? Will.
Thank you. That's a big question, and I'll be interested in other panelists' response to it. What we can say, these numbers from memory were broadly accurate. In September 2010, before there was a vaccine available, only about 60% of people were sure that they would take it. So there was a significant chunk of the population who were not sure. Months later, as a lot of those uncertain people had chosen to have the vaccine, and by now 9 out of 10 people in the UK have voted with their arms and had at least one dose of the vaccine. So whatever we talk about for people who've ultimately chosen not to have a vaccine, it's important to remember that the vast majority of people have made this choice together. I think what we found is that the clearer and more consistent public health messaging, the more effective it is. And it took time sometimes to get that clarity. But there were groups of people who were less well served by the general messaging and who had good rational reasons to be hesitant. And I think very often it's possible to sort of portray people who are hesitant about having a vaccine as unreasonable. It's important always to understand what are people's good reasons for being hesitant. And in this case, for example, Black people were less likely to get the vaccine, particularly early on. And there is a long history of medicines not being appropriately tested with Black people and so on. And there are good grounds for less trust in the medical system for Black people than for white people, and that played out. There are communities which are just less well connected with public health authorities and the health system, which there was a real difficulty in making those gaps, and huge efforts were made in terms of finding the right people in the right communities to talk to people and establish genuine dialogue, and that over time paid off. But there was always, you know, there was always a group of people who would go for it straight away and just basically need to be told when and where. There was always a group of people who needed to be told when, where, and here's a decent reason to believe it's safe. And then there was a group of people who needed much more dialogue. And in 9 out of 10 cases, we got there eventually, if you see what I mean. And ultimately, full facts point of view is whether you choose to have a vaccine or not is entirely up to you. It's not our job to persuade you to do anything. It's our job to make sure you have the best information possible to make up your own mind. But from a point of view of the vaccine rollout specifically, as opposed to other aspects of public health intervention, it's just worth remembering that, you know, much more than 9 out of 10 would be a pretty amazing result.
Okay, thanks very much. I think everybody else wants in, so I'll ask you all to be quite brief. Tracy Brown, first of all.
But first, I think just worth noting that in drawing conclusions about, you know, how much people consumed dodgy information, we did actually lock lots of people up indoors with only their social media to kind of stay in contact with each other. I doubt that is that representative, and I know a lot of people contacted us talking about their... They just became very exhausted with all that stuff as well. And they began to spot patterns in the way that people were trying to manipulate them into believing their version of events, their alternative version of events. I also think it's worth noting that in the countries of the UK, people largely trust state institutions for information. We don't have the kinds of problems that South Africa had or the USA had, where people would go to their preachers, for example. There was a lot of online preaching going on that was far more problematic than anything we faced in these countries. On the vaccine stuff specifically, I really agree with what Will said, that I actually think the 60% I was a bit shocked by. I don't think any decent scientist should sign up to a vaccine that they haven't seen the statistics for, and none of us should have really said yes to that one in a way. But it was absolutely true that people did get vaccinated, and to a really amazing degree, and very quickly, without a great deal of effort for most of it. The two things that I would really want to highlight, and I'd love to see this committee highlight, are first of all, that I thought that the MHRA really missed an opportunity. There was a bit too much speaking at people, not with them. We could have heard so much about what were the criteria for making the judgment about the vaccine before the vaccine was assessed. Take people with people on that journey. I think regulators have got a job to do there to explain how, what questions they ask. So that we all as a society become part of asking those questions. And then when the answers come, it doesn't feel as though that they're then sort of backfilling the explanation of how rigorous that questioning was. That would have been a good thing. And I think also we're hearing from, and I haven't bottomed this out myself, but we're hearing from specialists in public health, and particularly people who are sort of veterans of HIV in the UK, that their experience of building relationships with communities was underutilized. There was a very sort of very centralized approach to vaccine information, and it was only latterly that there was an appreciation of just how much community trust building needs to go on, particularly with the kind of communities that will make reference to some of them. But you know, HIV was a huge success in the UK in terms of, and actually in Scotland particularly, really good at getting people to be frank about their drug use or their sexual habits. Those relationships were very solid, and we perhaps didn't make as much use of those early on.
Okay. Callum Hood, please. And if you'll be fairly brief, because we're running out of time.
Yes. I mean, I'll just say, you know, obviously people with anxieties about vaccines would often turn to social media to have those anxieties answered. And unfortunately, due to the prevalence of or disinformation, they would often have those anxieties or questions answered with complete falsehoods. I have to say, throughout the course of my research on these topics, it was striking how often searching for information about the latest conspiracy theory or piece of misinformation was more likely to surface more of that misinformation than reliable answers. And it was sort of gov.uk, black and white pages, versus, you know, sort of somewhere down in the Google rankings versus all singing, all dancing marketing campaigns by the sort of professional disinformation spreaders that I've talked about previously. So I think there's probably some lessons to be learned about thinking of very simple and effective ways of ensuring that people who are seeking answers on some of these anxieties get the best information presented to them, you know, at top of the Google search ranking or easily accessible on social media in an engaging format.
Okay, thanks. And lastly, Don Holford.
Yes, some excellent points that the others have made. Two things. One, which is that public health information by ways that make it easy for people to follow them. So as if we go back to the vaccine rollout as an example, I think in Scotland, the letters were sent to people with the dates and times of appointments, or they had to do a show up. So that sort of highlighted the ease of access that you can have to getting vaccine. This perhaps wasn't done quite so well in England, where it was a booking system which would have left a lot of people who had problems with dealing with online bookings, and perhaps that's when the doubts that's when the doubts feed in as to is this really so important if it's that hard to do. The second thing I want to mention is about understanding misinformation and where it really stems from and what it's targeting, because we always see that new myths are springing up, but they tend to cluster under recurrent themes. So we've done some research on this to see that these themes also tap into logical characteristics of the audience it's trying to reach. So some are focused on stoking fear, some are invoking pushback against perceived restrictions, some are pushing conspiracy theories, others are specifically targeting religious beliefs. So if you think of these, the roots of the misinformation, we have to understand why it's so compelling to people, because it speaks what they're worried about, and these could be various different reasons.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Can I just a reminder to witnesses, it's helpful to get examples, but can I suggest that we please avoid naming individuals? Can I move on to Alex Rowley?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Could I begin with Dr. Don Holford? In your submission, you say there is considerable collective and diverse expertise amongst researchers that could support government in communicating science and public health messaging based on evidence-informed principles. But you then go on to say, however, there is a lack of infrastructure to help with rapid consolidation of this expertise to enable it to happen. Could you expand on that a bit, what you mean by lack of infrastructure, please?
Yes. So what we mean, what we see, what SciB has specifically seen here is that distributed around the UK, around the world, there are a lot of research scientists who are looking in the area of public health communications and know certain principles about making, for example, matching public health information with the behavioural support that will enable people to follow the instructions given. We also know what's the best way to present risks in terms of, say, fact boxes that can help people understand and weigh up what are the trade-offs with regards to risk. We haven't seen this consistently applied across a lot of different countries in their public health communications. And we see that actually some of the problems are that perhaps it's really difficult to reach the scientists who have this knowledge because it's so distributed. So when we talk about infrastructure, we're looking at what sort of tools could, what sort of incentive structures, what sort of channels could we have to crowdsource, in a way, this collective expertise? And we make that point because when we do so, we can also see the level of scientific consensus in how a public message should be developed. It's about how can we connect scientists who may be working on that specific question that policymakers wish to address and have them respond within the given time frame that's needed to put that message out there.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask the panel, in terms of looking back over the COVID period, what are the key lessons for government? What should government or could government do better? So what are the key lessons? And secondly, in terms of communication, the comparison between Scotland and the rest of the UK. I think in Scotland, the First Minister had a press conference near enough every day and was communicating a message, and generally that was certainly well received. It was less so in the UK government, but the UK government, certainly their press release briefs used to be much more informative. People like the Dr. Whitty, Jonathan Van Tam, never had been heard of before, now household names, and very informative. So what could government do better? How did it perform, and what are the lessons? Can start with Tracy Brown, please.
That's a really big question. I would draw attention to the fact that there was conflict within government's approach. If we're talking about sort of the relationship, the information that was given out, the communication with people, there was conflict in government's approach between what we've characterised as an authoritarian and an authoritative approach. So an authoritarian approach is, you know, tell people hands, face, tell them they've got to, you know, can only go out for a walk once a day, and locking doors, and hope that they'll police each other around those things. Not very much reasoning with people about why those things were being emphasised. The authoritative approach, which was favoured by Chris Whitty, you can see that in the way that he presented information, was often in tension with that. And there's a behavioural science argument behind that that came out at Spybee, which was, is it better to just give people simple messages that they can police, or is it better to lay out the unknowns, you know, where the gaps are, what this is our best guess, those kinds of things. What it showed was that initially you can get across a very simple, you know, set of rules. But of course, as information changes, as we learn more and the situation changes, you've got to change those rules. And then it becomes a complete mess of, you know, outdated information. Hands, face, space, for example, Sage was advising the government to change that and emphasise ventilation for months before any change happened. And in to this day, I mean, some of you may notice we still get wipe downs on trains and things like this, which one wonders who's directing them. We had conflicts raised with us, particularly in Scotland, between lots of different bodies, and particularly professional bodies being giving advice that was no longer in keeping with what the government was saying. So there was confusion, and I think the only way through that is to take the authoritative approach. I think there's generally a feeling that that would have been a better thing to do. It could also be said that, you know, if you take the authoritarian approach and you just emphasise rules, then when people perceive the breaking of those rules or that they're no longer relevant, then that also undermines profoundly the authority. So I think that's a particular important tension. And there are perhaps a number of other areas that government could have, where government could have taken people on the journey of understanding where the gaps were. I mean, there's something that I would draw a distinction in between Scotland and the UK government. I think the First Minister in Scotland is probably closer to departments, and there wasn't such a feeling coming from Scottish decision making of a sidelining of expertise. In fact, if anything, there was a much greater involvement of departmental expertise. What happened in the UK government was a huge centralisation in Number 10 that for the first part of the pandemic, certainly until the end of 2020, that's sort of November 2020, things changed again. Everything was being done by press release. I think more than 60% of policies were being announced that way, which meant they didn't go through the usual policy making process. Therefore, policy documents weren't available. 90% of policies announced had in the early stage of the pandemic had no link whatsoever to any evidence base. There was nothing there that you'd normally expect. And departments were sidelined, and departments are where expertise sits about stakeholders. And about how measures might affect different communities. And I think a lot of that opportunity to feed back in and test policies was probably missed. And I don't think that applies quite so much in Scotland.
OK, thank you. Callum Hood?
Well, my organisation specialises in social media, so I'll just make three quick points on some perhaps gaps on social media. The first I've referred to previously, which is that I think probably the government could have done a little bit of a better job of surfacing their best possible answers on various circulating questions or anxieties or conspiracy theories, and making sure those were as accessible as possible to the public. Often seem to be a little bit behind on that. The second is using a variety of messengers. So, like you said, I mean, they did sort of successfully make people like Jonathan Van Tam a household name and a source of sort of central authority on some of the questions that people had. What they were less good at was using all the resources available to them. You know, we've got the NHS spread throughout the entire country and lots of different communities, lots of different types of people involved in the NHS, lots of potential messengers. And I think, you know, we could have selected a wider variety of messengers to develop, to deliver good information to people and deliver that information from messengers who look and sound like them and are closer to them in their local communities. But probably the third thing is the government has to tackle the social media companies. They did really quite a bad job during the pandemic. You know, one of the sort of very basic measures we used was how much of COVID or vaccine misinformation do they take down when it's reported to them? And the last time we audited this, they failed to act on 88% of that content that's reported to them. So government's obviously, and we've also got the online safety bill, who's currently making progress, but government needs to find ways to put a bit more pressure on the social media companies to do a better job of tackling this, because we are likely to face similar public health crises in the years ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Dr. Dawn Holford.
Yes, so I'd like to clarify some points about making things simple for people. We don't necessarily mean making messages simple and authoritarian. We just mean that we need to support the messages with ways that it's easy for them to actually do the things that are best for their health. I do very much agree with Tracy's point that we cannot present false certainty around information, particularly in a crisis, because that information is going to change with new evidence, and we have to expect that. It may be counterintuitive, but one thing we need to learn is that sometimes we do need to acknowledge this uncertainty, and the research actually shows that not necessary to avoid presenting uncertainty in the information or the evidence that is currently available. People are actually receptive if we're able to explain what it is we do know, what we don't know, and why that's going to change quickly. And it could also be a way to signpost that they do need to stay updated, and here are the trusted information sources that they should go to get the latest updates. I'd also like to reiterate the point of actually using more trusted resources. More research has shown that the public has increased their trust in scientists especially, which could actually mean the government could do more to give the right platforms to connect all these resources, these people, the scientists, the healthcare professionals, people working in the NHS with communities, or actually also provide them with guidance and training to deal with misinformation that might come out from the communities. So I do some work with healthcare workers, and what we're hearing is that sometimes they don't know how to address the misinformation because they don't know what the right answer is themselves. One case that came to me last year was a nurse who said, actually, my patients are saying their insurance will be invalidated if they get the vaccine. And she couldn't hand on heart say that this wasn't the case. So actually being able to have an up-to-date resource, give the healthcare professionals, so they can give their patients the information from a source the patients trust, is something that the government could improve on for the next in the future.
Thank you. And Will Moy?
3 points about preparation, good information, and audience fragmentation. The first thing to say about the pandemic was it was number one on the UK National Risk Register. Everybody who thought about this knew it was going to happen, and yet we were unprepared for the communication challenge that came with it. And in retrospect, I really regret full fact small part in that. Good information in a crisis requires a whole of society response. It requires government to work with media, internet companies, civil society organizations like Full Fact and the others in front of you, academics and so on. And we had not had a dress rehearsal, a practice of thinking about what this might look like. And that was a bad miss. We should go through the National Risk Register and actually game out what would it take to be prepared. One of the lessons full factors have learned from this situation has been working with representatives from the UK and Canadian governments, internet companies and civil society organisations around the world to create what we call a framework for information incidents, which sets out in an open and transparent way how you would identify that an information incident is happening, what kinds of responses might be called for, how you would say how serious it is, and how you would say how effectively that information incident is being responded to. I think it would be well worth the Scottish Government looking at that framework and having a dialogue about how that might apply in preparation for future emergencies, because every emergency nowadays comes with information risks attached to it. So that's the first thing. We could have been prepared and we should have been prepared. The second thing is audience fragmentation. Every source of information that is growing in the world now provides different experiences to different users. Social media, Netflix, whatever it is. Every source of information that is shrinking provides the same experience to all its users, traditional newspapers, TV, radio, and so on. This means that it is easier and cheaper to reach small numbers of people than it's ever been, and harder and more expensive to get the same message to everybody. And that is a profound challenge for public authorities who are essentially used to thinking, if we can get on the Today programme or the front page of the newspapers or BBC Scotland or whatever it is, we've got our message out there. And that's just not true anymore. Fragmented audiences create opportunities for causing confusion. They create opportunities for people to be in different information environments and be misled. And public authorities have to work harder to get good information out in this new environment. I don't think we've adjusted to that reality yet of audience fragmentation.
Okay,
and then thirdly, I talked about the unlikely journey of good information, having to start from actually doing the research, doing the analysis, and ultimately communicating it. To think about this problem well, you need to think about every stage of that journey.
Okay, thank you. And Tracy Brown, you wanted to come back in if you are brief.
Very brief. Parliaments, I think parliaments need to also look at this. You are our way of scrutinising government. That's where the power to scrutinise government lies. And I think being able to scramble quickly, because obviously this presented some practical problems for you about meeting. And also, we've just won Evidence Week in Holyrood, and we do the same in the UK Parliament. How well equipped you are to kind of question in some of these complex areas, and whether you have the resources you need to do that. I really think that's a question that needs addressing too.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thanks very much, convener, and thanks very much to the panel for turning up. I have to say, when I started reading all of this, there was a band in the 80s that I loved called The Jam, and they wrote a song called Going Underground. And one of the lines in one of the songs is, you choose your leaders and place your trust. And that, to me, is probably the most fundamental thing, because all the other nuances that we talk round about, if we don't trust our leadership, none of this is going to matter. Now, I could be completely wrong in saying that, and I'd be interested to hear your views. But we've got a bit of a dichotomy, because, first of all, we need that trust, and you can come back in on that. But we've got science working at pace, trying to keep up with something that we don't yet understand. We've got a public message going out, trying to get people to change their entire way of life. And at the same time, we've got leaders saying, but bear with us because we don't quite know what we're doing yet. So given what we've just been through, how do we pull all that together? Because there will be another one will come. How do we pull all that together and make it fit? Very simply, how do we do that? Tracy, I'll start with you.
People were very tolerant at the start of the pandemic, very tolerant. When we interviewed people from many walks of life, and so we, for example, we talked to unions about their experience, and people who were not very supportive of the UK government, for example, but showed a great deal of empathy for the position that politicians found themselves in. I think opposition parties were very restrained in their criticisms, and they were very supportive. The media was very restrained in the early days and similarly supportive and empathetic to the unknowns, the difficulty of making those decisions. So I think what people showed was an enormous amount of tolerance for the situation and for the uncertainty that was in that. I think some of this kind of idea that the public need uncertainty it's just not well-founded. I think Dawn made that point, that people actually do trust information when it's got caveats around it as much as anything else. The survey work showed that people's trust in science was pretty rock solid throughout, and in fact in medical science went up. So I think that's quite an important base to start from, that there is a lot of opportunity to have that discussion about the fact that we don't know things, that we're making decisions in the absence of perfect knowledge. The reason why we're doing research is because we don't know things. And that was important too. And also, perhaps there's a bigger issue here, Jim, to sort of get across to the world at large, that we don't always have to know everything. We can have operational knowledge. We can make decisions based on just the knowledge we need right now.
Tracy, can I stop you there for a wee second? I'm going to go back to what both yourself and Will said earlier on. When you have that information gap, that's when it gets other stuff gets allowed to seep in. So there's a time gap there as well. So we've got information, we're working on it, stop living, stay at home, let us work it out, and in the meantime, somebody else is coming in and feeding other information in that is damaging.
So there's two different things here. I think what you're describing is often what maybe call a motive gap, which is people want to know what's government's reasoning. And if, you know, for example, the UK government was pointing to SAGE. If you read the SAGE minutes when you finally could, if you read those minutes, you could not get from there to the decision. People thinking, well, hang on, you must have had an economic calculation in here somewhere. You know, that the policy advice wasn't published, the economic advice wasn't published, only the science advice was published. There was a real lack of transparency elsewhere. And people could not see clearly what that motive, you know, what the reasoning was, what the chain of reasoning was for why particular decisions were made, particularly those that seemed to have quite adverse effects on them. So I think there's a bit of a difference between saying that and saying we don't yet know how long vaccine efficacy will last for, or we don't yet know how much transmission there is outdoors. You know, there's a real difference between that kind of information gap and saying, what have we based our decision on? And that is in that second one that I think we have problems and a gap that people are less tolerant of. Does that answer your question?
It does, yeah. Well, would you like to come in? Sorry, you're muted at the moment. Hold on a wee second.
Thank you very much. I couldn't agree with you more about the importance of trust and therefore trustworthiness from our leaders. And we think that boils down to three pretty simple principles. Firstly, you should get your facts right. Secondly, you should give sources for what you say so people can judge it for themselves. And thirdly, you should correct the record when you make mistakes. And by and large, if you do that, you will earn trust. And as Tracy said, people gave the benefit of the doubt in this situation. Whatever trust or distrust they may have had about political leaders in other contexts, that they were willing to give people a run at this situation. And that was important, and people had to live up to that. The area where I think we started to see a risk was where certain public health responses became politicized, and I'm thinking of mask wearing in particular, where in some places it started to feel like one political tribe saw this as a symbol of membership and another political tribe saw this as a symbol of giving in to excessive public health responses. And when that sort of, we moved from a pragmatic conversation about how do we deal with uncertain facts to a more, if you like, tribal conversation, we're getting into a bad place. And I think the UK has been relatively lucky compared to what I know of, for example, the USA, which is a horribly polarized political situation where even vaccination has had some of those problems. So I do think that the way we do politics does have an effect on how we respond to situations like that, and the willingness to work in nonpartisan ways, the willingness to take heat out of situations and so on, that kind of leadership, all of it matters. The culture of public life matters when we end up in an emergency.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for giving your time. I think as we've heard today, it seems to me as soon as there was information put into the public domain. All of a sudden, other experts were springing up, trying to say exactly the opposite. So I think that if I could ask, in the first instance, really, it's we seem to have a deluge of data been able to be collected. What's our ability to collate that data and then put that that communication into the public domain in a way that can be consumed easily? I'm thinking, potentially though that the fact that a lot of data was put onto websites, the FACTS website, for example, the NHN Inform website, and I'm not sure how many people actually visited that particular website. So, where the government's behind the, sort of behind the curve, if you like, in their ability to combat misinformation in that way? I'll go to you, Will, if I could. Well, you're muted. There you go. Yeah, you're back.
Thank you. And I know that Tracy has evidence on this as well. I will say that the experience was mixed. On the one hand, we had some data collation that was things like the COVID dashboard were used by millions of people and were a really regular source of information and were world-class bits of data publication. On the other hand, the government did not know how much PPE we had and where we had it. The government did not know how many people were living in care homes, not what their health status was or anything else, literally how many people were in care homes. The data vacuum around social care is frightening and I think almost certainly cost lives. So again, in this situation, the starting point of having good data and presenting it to the public is collecting it in the first place. And one of the lessons from this situation is to look at the data gaps we have in our public life and start to fill them and recognize that, that was a well-known problem, but we did not know what was going on in social care. It suddenly came up and became a life-threatening problem in a new way, and it could have been avoided. So we have to think about that whole journey. There are great examples of compiling good data in ways the public understands. The skills exist, the mechanisms exist, but you have to join all the dots in that unlikely journey of good information to make that happen. And in too many places, there was something missing somewhere along the line.
And if there's anybody else wishes to come in on that particular question before I add a supplementary to you, Will? No.
I think Tracy would like to come in.
Like to come
and
in.
Dawn's yeah. back. We and, did lose.
Yeah, okay, Tracy.
Our NatSense survey asked people about where they got information and how they experience government sources. We had a really astonishing result, finding that 35% of respondents said that they visited what was then the PHE data dashboard, now the UKHSA, which is absolutely astonishing because 35% of people normally have no relationship whatsoever with government websites. And 15% ONS. Again, I was expecting numbers in the 1 or 2. I was really, really astonished by that. A key thing, I think, is on social media, a kind of a cadre of people grew up, sprung up, sort of actuaries and real kind of honest broker type commentators who guided people towards a lot of those sources. People didn't, you're right to say that, to have some skepticism about government putting up an informed page. People didn't spontaneously find their way towards them. I'm not sure what architecture there needs to be in place, but clearly gov.uk needs a huge revamp because people, for example, Sage and others have commented to us, as many had before them, that they were suddenly struck with this problem of needing to share an awful lot of information. That was information they normally publish after a crisis. Suddenly had to share it in the here and now, in real time. That gov.uk is not set up to do that. So in terms of the supply, those data dashboard and the ONS material, I think, were two success stories that need looking at and looking at the pathways that took people to those places. In terms of the other way around, I think Will's mentioned it, but I think there are many holes that have been shown. You have Ed Humphreyson on at the next session, so I think this is perhaps a question for him, about things that we just don't seem to know. For example, we didn't know how many people, when we had flight bans, how many people were construction workers who work abroad for a week and come back at weekends to see their families who really couldn't cope with that kind of additional cost and burden. We didn't know what the impact of a lot of the things were that were imposed upon people. And there was people, many, many different groups told us, for example, chains of charity shops and others, told us there was no way of feeding that information back in. They were really struggling. They got together, a lot of them, to try and pool information to give the government, but they couldn't find the entrance door to put it in. Nighttime industries, you're probably aware, were really struggling with that as well. It wasn't all just about needing economic help. It was actually wanting to give information about their sector or their clients or their people who use their services into government. So I think there's something to be looked at there. I don't know whether it's a stop check or what, but it's perhaps a mechanism needs to be established by all in all areas of government policy making for people to input, because there's a lot of big data gatherers out there in society now. Don't think it can only be the job of government.
Okay, I've got to agree, Tracy, that there's that my mantra has always been that we don't have an IT system that actually can collate and gather the data and give us the output we need. I know Dr. Holford wants to come in this one.
To address the point about, for example, experts speaking out once there's information out there and just so much information overloaded. And I think that there's been a real gap here in not being able to consolidate the consensus of experts around any particular topic, because we know that showing the consensus level in any scientific information as it builds is quite convincing for people to see that this, even though it's developing, this is where the path is going. So I think that is something that could be done better, and it also tackles what we've said in our statement about the infrastructure. And we don't know what that's going to look like at the moment, but with individual scientists speaking out on Twitter, that can be really powerful in providing guides to what the evidence is and explaining it to people. However, there is also a danger when individual scientists are debunking misinformation or fact-checking, because there is a political nature to some of that disinformation. Just doing the act of fact-checking can turn people into it can lead others to perceive that they're being political when it's actually just basically fact-checking that shouldn't be. So that's one danger of having individual experts all commenting on social media or through individual channels.
And briefly, Callum Hood, I know you want something to say here.
Yeah, I'd say really briefly, look, the presenting lots of data and making it accessible on its own does not solve problems of misinformation. Indeed, the data often become the subject of a battle in terms of misinformation. The best example I can give of this is a US one, the VAERS system, which records any incidents that take place after a vaccination. That was actually a demand of the anti-vaccine movement many decades ago, but it is used by anti-vaxxers today to highlight any incident that takes place after a vaccination and claim that it was caused by that vaccination, whether it was injury, sickness, whatever. So data as a whole, and when it's analysed by experts, shows that the vaccines are very safe, but the data itself is then exploited by bad actors to spread misinformation. So there is a comms battle takes place over the data, even once it's out there and it's transparent and it's public, and we need to be mindful of that.
Thank you. I think, you know, could spend all day talking about, you know, data and collection and how we utilise it. If I just ask one more question here, though, I think one of the difficulties for me with what happened, certainly within in the UK and in Scotland, was we used the phrase a lot, follow the science, without actually explaining what follow the science actually means. And of course, we had the changing and evolving science as we began to understand more. So how did governments respond to that change, and how were we able to communicate that sort of change going forward? And did that, you know, compound the difficulty that we had maintaining a communication line? I'll go to Callum first, if I could.
I'll answer very briefly. You know, refer back to a bit what other panellists like Tracy have said. You know, the public have shown themselves to be capable of assessing complexities around this and to accept uncertainties around the evidence and around our theories of, you know, how dangerous COVID is or when we're going to get a vaccine and what they're going to look like, things like how many vaccines we'll have to take. You know, many members of the public can understand the uncertainties at play here and understand it's difficult and complex. The challenge is in communicating those uncertainties and trying to fill information gaps, even if you can only fill them by giving the public the sort of balance of probabilities. And we know that there's many people who stand ready on social media to fill those gaps with their own definite and concrete answers if we don't get there first and do that effectively.
Well, I saw you nodding your head. Is there something you would like to add to that?
I would say that Tracy will have interesting things to say about following science, but the other side of this is much of the pandemic management was about making trade-offs between public health and the economy. And there is not a science for that. And I think that was obscured a lot in the political communication. And that was actually obscured in the data gathering as well. We have much clearer data about what was going on with people's health, the health system, and what was going on with people's livelihoods and the economic system. And so I think thinking about a public health emergency as more than just a public health emergency and the policy decision making being more than just about preservation of life, we maybe didn't do a very good job of being open with that decision making. And that's where over time, I think perhaps there was room for distrust to come in.
Okay. Tracy, I would assume you would like to comment on the follow the science comment.
Yeah, I think it's probably worth noting that the UK government had just campaigned the kind of key Brexit campaign for leadership. And I think there was something of a self-talk going on there to saying, actually, this isn't like that, is it? It's something else we need to do here with the follow the science initially. What happened, though, it seemed, and a lot of people pointed to this when we spoke to different communities, was it seemed like no one was in charge later on. So when you asked people, you know, what were the basis for, you know, for this, you know, you ask the scientists, they say, well, it's not my decision, we just give the advice. And then you ask the government, they say, we're following the science. And no one seemed to actually be responsible for the decision making. So I think that became really problematic. In relation to that, how well the science was followed is another question and a much bigger one than we can deal with today. I do want to pick up this point, though, about there's kind of the science and then the economics and so on. I understand what Will's getting at, but, you know, people have said from that we've had too much dominance of the outputs of epidemiological models. What actually happened was that we weren't using them very well at all. I mean, for example, if you look at the SAGE modellers, they were more than capable of being able to incorporate closing schools into the models to look at, you know, how could we seek to optimise the impact on case numbers by doing the least amount of damage to children's education. They were never asked that question. So the questions as put became very narrowly focused on reducing cases, reducing hospitalisations, instead of actually using the tools that were there, bring science, scientific, you know, scenario mapping and so on into policy, they were very limited in what they did. And as we've talked about before, the Treasury didn't publish any of its own modelling, which must have incorporated some epidemiological material. They tell us it did. Whether it did or not is another question. We can't see it. But this is something that I think is quite important here. You know, the science is only going to be that goes into policy is only going to be as, you know, respond to the policy questions that are put. You know, SAGE was not busy going off investigating other questions. They were being having questions put to them by the Cabinet Office. And, you know, that's what we need to look at, is whether those questions really made good enough use of the tools that were needed to look at those kinds of trade-offs.
Thank you. Can we move on to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, convener. I was intrigued by one or two of the practical examples early on, and if I can start with yourself, Tracy Brown, the concept of the bus leaving the teenager on the road or picking them up because they didn't have a mask on. And I'm interested in kind of unpicking that bit. I mean, maybe the bus driver, maybe all bus drivers, maybe all of us should have understood better how efficient the masks were, what was the ventilation like on the bus, how busy was the bus, how far was the journey, all of these kind of factors. But that's probably a bit much to expect the bus driver to assess just right there. I mean, should it have been his company that was giving him better direction? Or is it the government should have been giving the bus company a clearer picture of how much flexibility it had? What went wrong there and what could we have done better?
Well, the same sort of dilemmas were being posed to us by people who were trying to develop the guidance for their organisation. And what was particular, so there are probably two elements to this, John, which is what one is the first is there was not enough information that enabled people to put the measures into a context. I'll just give you a couple of other examples. Do you, because a teenage girl will not take a COVID test, do you allow her foster placement to break? Because that's the rule now. You know, do you, as a teacher, yell at the kids coming in from break to keep 2 metres apart or to put their masks on? So the issue was one of those things, 10 times better than the other or equal? Another example, 2 metre distancing, at 1.8 metres, people could keep a family crisis centre open. They could manage the space to do that. Was 1.8 metres, that much worse than two in terms of did you now cross a transmission threshold? So it's not that people wanted to see, reams of data, but they did want some analysis to sit behind it or something that put it into a context for them that enabled them to weigh the degree of severity of a risk and the degree of effectiveness of the measures that they were being asked to take and therefore could make those decisions. So that's one area that needs to be looked at.
So can I ask you then, who should be should every individual bus driver or teacher or family centre be making that decision? Was it too rigid? Was the system too rigid?
No, I think that there is a lack of appreciation of just how centrally in government, a lack of appreciation of just how many of those kinds of decisions were then being prompted by the measures that sounded on the face of it very simple, mask up, didn't think through what this might mean in different settings. As I've said before, I think, more involvement of government departments, local and community outreach from government is one way of kind of being more attuned to that. But there wasn't that appreciation. And if there had been, then the kind of information that people could use more effectively would have been forthcoming. But clearly it was the responsibility of groups, it was local health visiting services, or it was people who were, at the head of an organisation who were making those recommendations. But then that comes you to the other issue, which is discretion. Because, of course, you can look at the bus driver thing and say, we'll just use your common sense. But in a situation where these rules are being put across almost as public order, potential public order offences, it's really not clear to people whether they've got that discretion. So sometimes governments seem to be saying, here's the rule, do with it what you will. And other times they said, here's the rule and there's a £10,000 fine if you break it. And it moved according to whether we were closing down or opening up. Lots of people said to us, we just didn't know whether this responsibility was ours, whether in our sector, for example, small business owners, should we be developing our own recommendations or not? Or could we end up telling our members to break the law or something? It's not clear what's guidance, what's not. So people were missing that bit that they could say, well, this is what the policy is aiming for. And therefore, I can see how we could achieve that in our sector without doing harm to people. And that's the bit where there was the biggest deficit of what people needed. I'm not saying, people make good on the spot decisions like bus drivers. I think people's discretion is often fantastic. Police also made a lot of sensible decisions. We hear a lot about the bad ones they made. But I think, there was not equipment for people to do that either individually or at sector level.
Okay, thanks for that. And Will Moy, your example was with pregnant or potentially pregnant women and the varying advice that kept changing. And I just wanted to, again, explore that one a bit. I mean, I think, as I understand it, when the vaccines came out at first, they hadn't been tested on pregnant women. So logically, it was said pregnant women will not be getting the vaccine to start with. But in a sense, that put a question into people's minds that maybe it was dangerous. for pregnant women. And maybe Dr. Holford, you can come in as well, because this bit about acknowledging uncertainty and avoiding false certainty, well, in a sense, they did do that with pregnancy. They acknowledged the uncertainty, but that in itself kind of created a problem, did it not?
Yes, I think that's fair. There is a difference between saying, out of an abundance of caution, although we have no reason to believe there is a risk, for the time being, we are going to say, hold off a bit, and then we're going to run some special tests in order to give you the best possible advice we can, and here's the vaccine, pregnant women don't take it. And the public health messaging was much closer to the second. So yeah, naturally, it plants a seed of doubt in reasonable people's minds. And you're talking about a time and a situation where everybody is more health conscious than perhaps at almost any other time of life. You know, everyone wants to protect their child. And then you have a series of specific questions. So things like, can the vaccine cross the placenta into the fetus? What effect would it have on the fetus? That kind of thing, about which there was all kinds of uncertainty. There were, you know, good scientific reasons to think various answers were true, but all that needed unpacking. So it's not just sort of, should I have a vaccine, but what effect will this have on my child? And then when in pregnancy can I have this vaccine? Should I have a second dose if I've already had a booster? Lots of practical questions. And I think Tracy's point about community engagement is crucial here. If there had been somebody somewhere in the system whose job was just to think about this particular demographic group, you know, youngish people who might be having children, let's make sure we thought it through from their point of view, and somebody else who's thinking about it from point of view of schools and so on, it's not obvious that conversation was happening before this stuff got confused. I wonder if there's a lesson about stakeholder engagement and two-way dialogue in that.
Okay, thanks for that. And I mean, the final issue I just wanted to raise was that last week we had the Royal Society of Edinburgh giving us evidence, and they were quite keen on the idea of some kind of independent fact-checking service. So I don't know, maybe that's what some of you feel you're doing. People can check with you. But I just wondered, I don't specifically have this for anybody, but Will Moy going to come in again? Is that something that we should be looking at going forward? Oh, sorry, it was Mr. Hood.
If I may, Full Fact is the UK's independent fact-checking service, and we absolutely believe there should be a fact-checking service for Scotland specifically. I am hugely disappointed that I cannot come here and talk to you about specific examples from Scotland, how the Scottish institutions performed and so on. Although some of our staff are based in Scotland, the value of having a Full Fact Scotland, which would be based in Scotland, dealing with the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government, Scottish institutions and players, is something we really believe in and have tried to explore with funders before. So we are very open to working with partners to try to develop a fact-checking service in Scotland, of Scotland, for Scotland. And I think it's really important to stress that fact-checking isn't just about publishing fact-checks. It's about being the first responder to misinformation that helps other institutions understand the role they can play in reducing the harm that it does, that engages with that full pipeline of good information and has conversations like these that can help ensure informed and improved public debate.
Okay, thanks very much. Now we're beginning to run out of time, I think, but Mr. Hood, do you want to come in, and then Tracy Brown?
Just very briefly, CCDH is not primarily a fact-checking organisation, but we are part of an ecosystem of organisations that look at the problems of misinformation and disinformation, and the work of people like Will at Full Fact is really important. It's really useful to us to have, like he says, a sort of first responder who's able to check some of the most prevalent misinformation or disinformation narratives out there and helps us do our work holding platforms to account on their role in the spread of mis and disinformation. So fundamentally seems like a good idea to me.
Good, thanks. And Tracy Brown?
Well, I'm not going to repeat what's been said, but related to this, one of the recommendations of our What Counts report is that there should be a publicly responsive trials unit. I think that needs to be scoped as to whether it needs to be one in each of the governments of the UK. But the idea would be that people can, as things are unfolding around them, say this is raising questions. I don't, you know, does government have answers for this? But also MPs could do that and MSPs could do that. So that's something that I think we need to take forward, is an opportunity to ask, you know, do we actually have the information available? Are we gathering it? Because sometimes you can't just respond to misinformation because we don't know, you know, we haven't got the stuff at our fingertips, and we need to be running more trials as things are rolled out. So if someone's alleging that masks are causing harm, or someone's alleging that, you know, ventilation doesn't work or something, you know, we need to be running trials as those things are rolled out.
That's great. Thanks so much. Thanks, Convener.
That's great. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence this morning and giving us their time. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. everybody. Now we will continue to take evidence on the inquiry. I would like to welcome our second panel to the meeting, Dr. Nick Finn, the Organisational Lead for Strategic Engagement and Policy in Public Health Scotland, Stefan Webster, the Regulatory Affairs Manager of Ofcom, and Ed Humphreyson, Director of General for Regulation Office for Statistics Regulations. Thank you very much for giving us your time this morning. As I explained to our earlier panel, this is the committee's first evidence session on the inquiry, and there'll be a further session on the 23rd of June before we hear from the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport on the 30th of June. Each member will have approximately 10 minutes each to speak to the panel and ask their questions. And can I please invite the witnesses to briefly introduce yourselves? Shall we start with you, Stefan?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'm Stefan Webster and I lead on Ofcom's work around broadcasting and online content in Scotland. There are three areas of Ofcom's work that will be of particular interest to this inquiry, I suspect. One is our role in enforcing standards across TV and radio, particularly how they adequately protect audiences from harm and offence, which was obviously heightened during the pandemic. We have a duty to promote media literacy across the UK, so that's around how citizens are digitally engaged, how they're smart and savvy online, and indeed how platforms design themselves to make sure that they're accessible to as many people as possible. And Ofcom's been named as the UK online safety regulator and the UK government's online safety bill, which is currently making its way through the UK Parliament.
Thank you very much. Dr. Finn?
Good morning, Convener. My name's Nick Finn. I'm currently Director of Public Health Science and Medical Director at PHS. For the last 20 years, I've been involved in communicable disease control, both at local and national level. I moved to Colindale in London to work with the Health Protection Agency in 2007, and I ran the Pandemic Flu Office for a number of years. I was one of the incident directors in the 2009 pandemic, and I've been subsequently involved in a number of major incidents, infectious disease, throughout the life of HPA and Public Health England. Laterally, I was the director for the Centre for Communicable Disease Control in London. And then when we moved to be, we had a reorganisation, I was the Deputy Director for the Infectious Disease Service. At the start of the pandemic, I was one of the two incident directors for Public Health England. And I moved to Public Health Scotland in January 2021 to take up my current post. And I've been involved in leading the Public Health Scotland COVID response since then. So, if you like, I've seen both sides.
Thank you, Dr. Finn. Can I bring in Ed?
Hi, I'm Ed Humphreyson. I'm head of the Office for Statistics Regulation. And what we do is we ensure that statistics serve the public good. And we do that by setting the standards that any government department or agency anywhere in the UK must follow when they collect and present and communicate statistics and data through a code of practice, a statutory code of practice, which has three principles: trustworthiness, quality and value. And we also step in where statistics are either not available, so there are gaps, or where they're presented inappropriately. And I think in the context of debates on misinformation, which we're talking about today, our role is quite focused. It's about the public's right to access high-quality official statistics and data. That's what we're here to safeguard and preserve.
That's great. Thank you very much. I'll turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Stefan, if I can come to you, just enforcing a standard, do you think that misinformation has increased during the pandemic, or do you think it's always been there?
It's something we don't have a huge amount of data on, unfortunately. When we were expected to become the UK's online safety regulator, we did commission some research in around 2019 to look at the kind of harms that were prevalent online. And misinformation was up there. It was the third most cited source of harm back then. We would have liked to have continued that research, and actually that would have been an interesting trend set going into the pandemic. But we weren't able to carry out comparable research given the, you know, you were unable to go and do face-to-face interviews and things since then. So we don't have a reliable trend data since pre-pandemic. What we did see during the pandemic was actually in the early stages was when misinformation was most often cited by people for coming across it. And then that levelled out over the following 2 years, albeit there was still... And actually, the issues you were seeing were different as time went on as well. So there was an interesting trend within the pandemic, but I don't quite have the evidence base to see how it's changed pre-pandemic to now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's interesting. I just remember in the beginning of the pandemic, probably going back to March, there was a lot of social media about Italy at the time and what they were going through. And then all of a sudden it just disappeared and you couldn't get any information from that either. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that question.
From my perspective and my experience, given I've had responsibility for vaccination, both in England and now in Scotland, vaccines are one area where we tend to see a lot of people with very strong views, one way or another. And those people with strong views tend to broadcast them using social media. And if you were to look at the number of social media sites which are promoting vaccine and compare them to the number where the view is against it, it's quite staggering. It's about 100 to 1. And I'm paraphrasing because this number is constantly changing. But suffice it to say, there are many more sites promoting messages against vaccination than there are promoting it. And so, I mean, since really MMR scare back in the late 1990s, early 2000, we've been struggling against that. People who almost saw the evidence from Wakefield as a sort of banner, a rallying call. And as a consequence, it's really been an uphill struggle to try and put forward the facts. And I think the way that it's been approached by and large has been to stick to the facts, not to directly confront people, and over a period of time provide the evidence that people can then see. But from my perspective, I've certainly seen a lot of it around for a number of years.
Thank you.
I don't have any more evidence than Stefan. I do have a sort of a perception, though, and I'll share that. And the perception is that the pandemic concentrated our attention on one issue where misinformation was particularly rife. I think that's more plausible than saying there was a sudden surge in the volume of misinformation. It was more that everybody was looking at one issue across not just our society, but across the world. And that not only highlighted all of the data and statistics, but it also shone a light on the extent to which there is a degree of misinformation.
Thank you. If I can move on to Dr. Finn regarding Public Health Scotland. What has been done to evaluate the public health communication throughout the pandemic?
I think it's important to state at the outset that when the pandemic started, Public Health Scotland's role was mainly in terms of advisory, providing the information, the data. Scottish Government took control of the communication, which was the role that many governments have done, which is to try and ensure a consistent one version of the truth, which I think is actually incredibly helpful when you're trying to provide factual information. Throughout the pandemic, we've conducted a number of surveys, and I'm very happy to give the committee links and to give the committee the reports, which demonstrate that, trying to understand the effectiveness of the message, trying to identify communities where the it is problematic. We've used the data from things like vaccine uptake, from the data we have around the number of cases, to try and focus in on those areas. And usually those are around areas of deprivation, where there are minority groups. And it's then about trying to provide information that's sensitive, both culturally and linguistically, and working through community leaders, which was actually something that happened as the pandemic evolved. Initially, there was an information sharing, And then it was appreciated for certain communities, working with leaders within those communities, sometimes faith leaders, giving them the information was a key way of providing information to that community. These were respected individuals who spoke often with authority and for whom people would listen to rather than some of the standard means. But, you know, we had information saying that there were problems with the blind, with the deaf, and what we tried to do is to try and provide appropriate material to try and address their means. And again, I'm happy to provide some examples of that if the committee would wish.
That's great. That's very helpful. Thank you. Just a brief reminder that if we cannot name individuals just during this evidence session. If I can move on to Murdo.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could just follow up the Convener's last question to you, Dr. Finn. And I was very interested that your perspective had changed because you were working south of the border and then moved north during the course of the pandemic. So you've got that double interest. In terms of the public health campaigns and how effective they were, I remember there was quite an effective slogan we saw coming out of the UK Health Department, hands, face, space. I don't know if that was your brainchild. No, it's not. But in Scotland, we had facts. And I've yet to find anybody who could tell me what facts stood for. So can you help us out? Can you remember what facts stand for?
I have to say I was south of the border at that time, and I'm afraid I can't. Okay. But in answer to your question, very much communications was led centrally. Yep. We would provide the advice. The hands, face, space was something that was developed by Cabinet Office and the Department of Health and Social Care. We provided the facts. They tried to then, you know, make it into something memorable.
Yeah. Sorry, it was a rather unfair question on facts. But I think the point I was trying to make was it was designed to be a simple message, but in actual fact ended up unduly complex. And I wonder, just following up on the convener's question, is there work being done to try and understand how effective that sort of a message was? Did it cut through with the public? Was it easily understood?
I think the other thing I just want to say is that Scotland doesn't work on its own. We work as part of the UK. So we would be contributing to SAGE, which is a scientific advisory group on emergencies. We would also be inputting into SPY-B, which is the behavioural scientist group. And very much we'd be looking to those committees and groups to advise on the best approach that we could recommend with respect to that. In terms of evaluation, again, I won't go through some of a number of pieces of evaluation have been done. I don't have them to hand, but I'm very happy to provide the committee with those at a later date or whenever.
Okay, thanks. One issue that was touched on by my colleague Alec Rowley in the previous panel was about how messages were communicated. So we saw regular briefings on television, particularly in the early years of the campaign. Do you have any evaluation on who were the best communicators of these messages, insofar as, you know, so we saw politicians, we saw Boris Johnson, Nicola Sturgeon giving these messages. We also saw people like Jason Leach, down south, Chris Whitty. You know, did people take these messages better from politicians or from those who were medically professional in these areas?
I don't have any specific evaluation done during this pandemic, but I am aware that work that's been done with the members of the public about who they would trust. Consistently, doctors, medical professionals have rated very highly, mm-hmm. and I think we're looking at something like 70 or 80%. Politicians tend to be in the lower half of the curve.
That's very diplomatically put.
That's the Ipsos Mori Veracity Index, which has been referred to there. And yeah, those are indeed the findings.
Okay, thank you. And just one more thing I wanted to ask, and maybe I could bring in Stephen Webster too from Ofcom's perspective. Clearly, throughout the pandemic, there were stages where Scotland and the rest of the UK were doing different things at different times, and the rules were changing. And so people would be watching, you know, the 6 o'clock news and hearing a message from, you know, Chris Whitty or the UK government saying one thing, and watching then the Scottish news where Nicola Sturgeon or Jason Leach would be saying something different. Is there any evidence that that caused confusion with the public? Was that a problem that was identified?
I'm not sure if there's any specific research that went into that. I would say, just in terms of the mediums that were used, I can see there was logic behind using television as a way to, you know, reach a mass audience quickly. We asked people where they were getting their news about COVID-19 from right throughout the pandemic, and 3/4 of the online population in Scotland were using the BBC initially. The second most cited source was other traditional broadcasters, so the likes of STV and Channel 4 and Sky News, followed by social media and official sources as well. Obviously, within that, there'll be differences within the age groups. But I think, you know, we saw huge audiences for those news shows that you mentioned there. I think both the Reporting Scotland and STV News at 6 both had record viewing shares throughout 2020 and into 2021. And, you know, the BBC's decision to carry briefings were getting obviously huge. It was a good way to get messages across, and using commercial advertising, of course, was a way that was getting messages out across as well. So I can see there was clearly logic in using that, albeit you typically get an older audience on TV. Yeah. And we watch a lot of television in Scotland across the year in 2020. It was more people watch television in Scotland than any other UK nation.
And just one final point, just for clarity, does Ofcom have any role in policing what's on the internet? Do you have any locus in that at all?
Not at the moment. You'll be aware that UK government's proposing an online safety bill. It's very much a live issue. I think committee stage at the House of Commons has begun at the moment. So that will give us a role in holding social media platforms to account in terms of how they protect their audiences from a range of harm. So that's something that's very much a live issue.
Good. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Alex Riley, please.
Yeah, could I ask, one of the last members, the last panel, talked about us as a country being unprepared on communications. So there's lots of planning went in for different emergencies. I think there was criticism that we were unprepared for COVID because we were more prepared for a flu-like. But their statement was we were unprepared on communications. Would you agree with that? And if so, what is it that we need to learn, and what is it that we need to be better prepared for moving forward? I'll start with Stephen.
I think I'll go back to what I said previously. I mean, I think the role of we're very lucky in this country. I think we heard earlier about maybe some place abroad where we don't have as high trust in some of our traditional media sources. We have trusted, accurate, impartial news in Scotland. It's well regarded. It's highly viewed. So using them as a medium to get messages across makes sense from that regard. Albeit it gets a particular audience, and you have to. There's challenges with fragmentation that mean you need to use other sources as well. And I'm not sure how well that's maybe understood in terms of reaching younger audiences and underserved audiences, like Dr. Finn mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks, Ed.
I think if you look at where we have ended up in terms of the presentation and communication of statistics. And actually evidence more broadly. We've got this fantastic mechanism called the Daily Dashboard, which is now there. In Scotland, it's had over 45 million hits. Very, very helpful, allows people to drill down to a local level. You've got a kind of clarity of definition around what is meant by a case or hospitalisation or a death, unfortunately. You've got an understanding that you need to focus on excess deaths, and indeed you as a committee are discussing excess deaths. And more broadly, there are now mechanisms for getting the science advice that government receives into SAGE, as Nick mentioned, getting that promptly into the public domain. All of those things I've just mentioned are bits of infrastructure and definition and technology and data collection that have been developed sort of in an iterative way through the pandemic. And I think that I suppose a lesson to learn is to say those things should be kept in mothballs, because even if we don't need them on a daily basis right now, they are the infrastructure which helps rapid and efficient and, I think, effective communication of statistics and data to the public. All of which is to say that none of those things were sort of in a game plan on the 1st of March 2020.
Dr. Finn.
Yes, I think it's an interesting question. The question is probably prepared for what? The first SARS-related incident was back at the turn of the century, where we saw SARS, SARS-CoV, as it was at the time. And that was a disease that suddenly raised people's awareness of the pandemic potential, because the last pandemic had been really back in 1969, which was an influenza pandemic. And although it raised the profile, there were relatively few cases at a global level from that pandemic, and it was actually controlled within a reasonable period of time. We then saw the emergence of H5N1, which was an avian flu, and this suddenly rekindled the prospect of us seeing a pandemic similar potentially either to the 2018, the 1890, the 1958 or the 1969 pandemic, which were all flu-related. So the theme at that time was flu, and I was actually part of the WHO advisory committee looking at pandemic planning, and communication was a key issue that everyone's recognised. And we've recognised that since the 2009 pandemic, and in fact, one of WHO's sort of themes is crisis communication. The pandemic flu plans that were developed by the UK in 2011 had a strong emphasis on communication. And I know that, for example, for the 2009 pandemic, we were prepared, or the UK government was prepared. It had bought stocks of paper, which was stored in a warehouse, so that when it was decided appropriate, a letter could be sent to every single household in the UK, letting them know what was happening and providing them with information. So there had been a lot of thought given to, you know, communication being ready, paper was stockpiled, drafts were being written. But I think in this particular instance, what happened was it wasn't the expected scenario. And I think over the last 8 years, we've seen thinking change. So moved away from a pandemic. And in 2018, WHO brought in this notion of disease X, and disease X being a communicable disease with the potential for a pandemic. And the change there was that it suddenly opened up to other issues. It was in 2018, so given the time it takes for some of these things to develop and evolve, it was unfortunate that in 2019 we saw the emergence of SARS. Because I think taking that disease X approach, which there was a very strong emphasis on crisis communication, could potentially put us in a better condition, better state. So the timing was unfortunate. Everything was focused around a flu pandemic, because that was thought most likely. And communications were formulated around that. But I would say that a lot of thought had gone in to what would be needed for communicating. And we were able to activate that reasonably quickly. You know, trying to order several hundred tons of paper is no mean feat, and therefore thinking strategically to make sure it's stockpiled was part of the thinking.
Okay. Can I just briefly, Stephen, ask a question? I mean, communication, and I think television was the main way that, and I think the success of that was the vaccine uptake, despite all the misinformation on social media. But is there a balance there in terms of So we had the First Minister every day doing this press conference near enough, and I think the viewing figures show the majority were very much up for wanting to hear what was happening. But you then did have those who were saying, well, this is political bias. You had the odd bob going to the BBC and trying to create problems. So, you know, where does that leave you in terms of we have a crisis, we need to communicate, we have politicians communicating, but we have other politicians saying they're getting an unfair advantage. How did you deal with that, and how do you deal with that?
Yes, well, we did deal with that. So I think the BBC themselves obviously had people expressing their views to them about their coverage of the briefings, and they made their way to us as well. I think throughout the pandemic, the main area of the broadcasting code we would have focused on was in protecting from harm and offence. It was a different issue in terms of the Scottish Government's briefings. That was the due impartiality question. And that was, typically, we have a BBC First approach to dealing with complaints, which is unique for the broadcasters that we regulate. That means we would expect the BBC to investigate and give their own view as to whether they have breached the broadcasting code on those grounds before Ofcom would look at it. That did happen, so it came to us, and we looked at a number of Scottish Government briefings over a period of time and decided not to investigate them. We felt there was sufficient challenge. So when you talk about due impartiality, it doesn't mean, you know, the same amount of time needs to be given to one view and the other. It's about context. And we felt with the examples we assessed that there was sufficient context and challenge presented to the Scottish Government in those briefings, whether through journalist questions that came at the end of many of those briefings. And then I think the BBC themselves actually changed their approach at some point and introduced other expert views and occasionally opposition politicians as well to give additional views, additional context to what they'd heard in the update. So in our view, the BBC did uphold its requirement to report with due impartiality throughout the pandemic.
Thank you.
We'll move to John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. Maybe just to follow on that line of thinking. So when you've got an issue which is contentious and there's debate on social media, so for example, the vaccines is an obvious one, although I think the majority of people were for the vaccines, but say the masks, which is maybe a bit more of a grey area, and there's been issues about some masks are useful, some masks are not, or no masks are useful and masks are very useful. I mean, how are you expecting the broadcasters to deal with that? Should they be giving time to the kind of anti-vax and anti-mask people as well?
So freedom of expression is really important here when it comes to broadcasters. So, and there's a distinction between the regulated TV and radio sector and social media. Broadcasters are free, and rightly so, to discuss any issue they wish. They can challenge conventional wisdom, and actually in a public health crisis where, you know, a lot of restrictions were put on us, it's only right that they're questioning things and the decisions that are being made. If they are going to do that, though, and we made it very clear to broadcasters by issuing guidance early on in the pandemic, they have to do it in a way that provides context, doesn't undermine public health information, and ultimately protects audiences from harm. And I think there's a success story from TV and radio, in that of all the thousands of hours that covered COVID-19 since March 2020, we found 8 programmes in breach of the broadcasting code for not sufficiently doing that. And they were, you know, minority interest channels that probably weren't high-reaching, but nonetheless didn't quite provide that level of protection that we would expect a broadcaster to provide. And that's a very different story on social media, where, you know, it's not a regulated sector and there aren't the same kind of requirements.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you said doesn't undermine public health information, but the information was or the advice was changing as we went along. And again, on something like masks, I mean, some people were claiming that they would harm you because you'd keep all your bugs and you'd get more of them or that kind of thing. Again, the balance there between, you know, what is... Maybe the public health information is wrong. So, I mean, what happens then?
And I think the context is important. So I think it's fine to challenge that. And, you know, you can question things, but, you know, making clear where the evidence is, and if there is evidence and official information coming out there, it should be made clear to audiences that you know, the full range of information is there, and that they are, you know, ultimately going back to where the evidence is saying is reliable.
Okay, thanks. Dr. Finn, in answering the convener, I got the impression, correct me if I'm wrong, that you were basically saying that Public Health Scotland, your job's to present facts and not to really counter the misinformation, and just kind of what, hope that the facts will eventually win out?
I don't think it's hope. I think that's what experience has shown. And that was the approach that was taken with the MMR scare back in 2000. And basically, it was felt that by engaging, all you actually tend to do is to raise the profile. And invariably, there is a risk that actually you gather in more people who are supporting the notion that there's potentially a problem with the vaccine. And the experience was that actually not engaging directly with these individuals and continuing to promote through evidence, research, where you can, the message is really important, and using any opportunity we have. So we would use that through our webpage where information was contained. But again, it's dependent on people actually visiting it. I think one of the commentators in the last session mentioned 35% people were looking at the UK Gov website, which is actually an extremely high percentage for something that is often considered rather dry and difficult to use. So the approach was not to engage directly, but to continue to provide good, reliable evidence from trusted source. And that trust is really, really important.
And would you expect other people, like maybe politicians, to be countering the misinformation? Or do you just think none of us should do that?
Oh, no. I mean, I would hope that politicians would counter that. Certainly, we did briefings and information was provided. The chief medical officer would obviously brief and provide information. I don't think there was a concerted effort to try and engage politicians and use them as a sort of force. Maybe that's something that perhaps we should be considering in the future. But I'm not aware that that was a deliberate policy achievement or objective.
Right. I was going to come to you next, Mr. Humphreyson, but you come in if you want to comment on that.
Just coming on that point, I think it is very important to be timely and effective in responding to misinformation. But there's an art to doing it. And one thing that we've learned through our work with official statistics is to avoid overly repeating the thing that you think is wrong, because then you give it more oxygen. Much better approach is to reassert what you think is well, what you know to be right. And I'll give you a concrete example of this. I was in another parliament, maybe 400 miles or so south of here, a couple of months ago, and I was asked a question about a particular figure, which I regard as grossly misleading. This MP asked me this question about it, and I said, I'm refusing to repeat that number back to you because I dislike it so much. And then I said about three or four times what the correct number was. And to me, that's really important, because if you start to repeat the number, you just give it more attention and oxygen. Much better to re-emphasize the appropriate interpretation, the correct figure, as opposed to retreading your way through the misleading figure itself. Does that make sense?
That does make sense, but it leads me on to one or two other questions. So is it part of your role or your office's role or your colleague's role to then tick off or challenge organisations that misuse statistics or data or come up with false ones, or where are you in that?
Yes, but subject to sort of fairly clear conditions. So what we want is for the public to have confidence in statistics and data produced by the Scottish Government, the UK Government, all the departments and so on. The main way in which there could be that lack of confidence is that the figures aren't good, you know, they lack quality or they're not relevant to people. And that's where most of our work takes place. It's sort of upstream of the things we're talking about today. It's to do with the collection of data and the methodology and what questions that the data seek to answer. But one risk factor, which is the subject of today, is that the way the statistics are presented either directly misleads as to the underlying what the underlying statistics actually say, or creates the risk of others to reach misleading interpretations. And in those circumstances, we do step in, and we have done so repeatedly through the pandemic, usually in the form of addressing a public statement to the relevant government department from me or from one of my colleagues.
So would you have a relationship with Ofcom or with the BBC, or how does that work?
Certainly with Ofcom. Indeed, with Ofcom, we meet periodically and sort of exchange cases. We sort of say, we've been looking at this, this is how we are reading it, this is how are you reading it? Even though Stefan and his colleagues have a different locus of responsibility looking at broadcasters, the underlying kind of judgment space is quite similar. You know, what are you forming a judgment on? What evidence are you drawing on? What criteria are you using? So there's a very healthy professional exchange with Ofcom, and actually with the Advertising Standards Authority as well, who, in their context of advertising, undertake a similar role.
OK, and I think my final point then, that we had last week we had the Royal Society of Edinburgh suggesting they'd like to see an independent kind of fact-checking service. I mean, would you understand that? Would that just duplicate what you're doing, or do you think that might be useful?
No, it'd be tremendously useful. It'd be a fantastic complement. So when we do work looking at how the UK government has collected or presented statistics and data, we have a really good alliance, particularly with Full Fact, you heard from earlier, but a range of other fact-checking organisations that look at facts and information circulating at the UK media level. So that's great. They are first responders. It was a very nice phrase that we heard earlier. They are first responders, and they can sometimes bring our attention to things. We'll go into the government department and say, you know, there may be an issue here. We do all of the same activities for Scotland. We have a team based here, and we're very just as active, and you can look at our website and see how many things we've done involving Scotland. But we don't have the counterparty of the first responders. We don't have that sort of broader civil society kind of ecosystem to form an alliance with. And I think it would really enhance the effectiveness of our work, but who really cares about that? I think it would enhance the quality of public discourse in Scotland for the Scottish people, and then therefore enable statistics to better serve the public good. So that's a long-winded way of saying I very strongly support that suggestion. Yes.
OK, that's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. It's actually good to see you here in person. If I could start with Mr. Humphreyson there. I think I've long sort of talked about the need to create systems where we are not just a collection of data, but our ability to collaborate, communicate, our ability to use that data in the most effective way is not where it should be, not just in Scotland, but in the UK as well. And I think the pandemic has highlighted that to a great degree, that we need to do better. So where are we with that? What lessons are we learning from that? What actions have been taken to increase our sort of background IT system that allows a colossal amount of data to be gathered and collated?
So I think we focused a lot in our remarks so far on, or I at least have, on the data that were collected, were presented, were used. But just as important, I think, is the gaps, what wasn't available, and how to address those gaps. For us, we saw in Scotland three really salient and really significant worrying gaps. One was around data in covering social care, and that's, by the way, not just care homes, it's all recipients of social care, whether it's in a care home setting or in a domiciliary, you know, at home context. The second gap is primary care, what's going on in the primary care sector, people presenting to GPs as opposed to the core NHS system, and also statistics and data on ethnicity in particular, understanding different impacts on different communities. Now, the first two of those, in particular, I think speak to a pattern in public service delivery, which is tending to focus more on the collection of operational data for the delivery of the acute end of the NHS, where there's an awful lot of focus and there's tremendous attention to waiting lists and resources and so on, and much less on the things which are going on outside, out in the community. If you look at Audit Scotland reports, since time immemorial, they really highlight this imbalance between the acute sector and the community primary social care sectors. So I would say that the good news is there was a time when it was just us saying these things and we would be doing reports and you know, quite firmly, perhaps aggressively saying this is a problem which needs to be fixed. This is 2017, 2018. Now I think there's much more widespread recognition of the things that I've just mentioned within the NHS, indeed within Public Health Scotland, doing really good work on social care in particular. I think we now need to actually get on and fix it and fix those gaps, ensure the data are collected, that they're usable, they're accessible, and that they're explained as well. So I would say I would not be saying the job is done. I'd say that at least there's a start now.
If I could, I'm going to follow on to that with you, Dr. Fenn. I think it'd be remiss of me, given that who you represent here, given that we're mentioned specifically last week in an evidence session. We took evidence last week in private, one of the things that one of the professors who was a government advisor said to us was that it was so hard, almost impossible to get data from Public Health Scotland that they stopped asking for it. Now, this is not I'm not in an attack mode here, and I don't want you to be in defence mode here. But I'm just saying that because, you know, what we need to do is look back and learn, and look forward and how we deliver better services, better communication. So, from a Public Health Scotland perspective, given that statement there, what would Public Health Scotland be doing to improve that access to data going forward and to a better solution?
Without being defensive, I don't recognise that. because one of the things that we've been doing is we've been working with various people, UKHDR, which is the UK, an organisation which is trying to develop research networks and improve access to research data. And in fact, we've had various resources, donated money to improve infrastructure that would allow data linkage. And data linkage is one of the key factors which allows us to draw together all the disparate information systems to try and use them to answer some key systems. And there was a system which was a joint initiative with Public Health Scotland and some of the Scottish universities called EVE2, which was the, it's got two names, so forgive me. One was the Early Pandemic Evaluation and Antivirals and Enhanced Surveillance, which then became the Early Estimation of Vaccine and Antiviral Effectiveness, so EVE2. And this was a project really that was born out of the 2009 pandemic, which was activated at the beginning of the pandemic. And essentially what this project tried to do was to bring together and link data systems and provide researchers with access to that data in secure environments. And that's probably one of the key things, in a secure way, to allow them to do that research. Now, obviously, we do get requests which we have to reject because either they either breach patient confidentiality, they may be considered unethical, there may be a variety of reasons, but we have a system, and another one is called EDRIS, which is really working with the research community to try and channel researchers in a way that means that the research is done to a high standard. So that's one of the reasons why I'm saying I don't quite recognise that, because we have those systems in place to try and facilitate access to research. There are blocks to research. I think we're gradually overcoming the systems ones. However, we've got to recognise that confidentiality, a patient's right to privacy, and we cannot give unfettered access to all of the information we have. I mean, there are places where there are systems that can tell what the citizen does in China and Russia, and I'm not suggesting we go down that route. But there are issues in place that we have to respect around patient confidentiality. And indeed, it has been an issue both in Scotland and England around primary care, trying to get access to primary care. Because in Scotland, they've had to ask each practitioner for permission to access the data. And there are a fairly large number of practices. Mm-hmm. And that's quite time consuming. And in England, there was just a regulation was passed and it had to be shared. So slightly different approaches, but definitely wanting to work with researchers. We've co-published many pieces of research with academia and researchers. And, a lot of our work is based on having the research to then develop good evidence and guidance.
It would be really interesting to get the two of you together to find where the disconnect is, because there's two significant players in this. It would be interesting to understand where the disconnect is. And just finally, one small question, just following on from my colleague John Mason there, around the way in which television and radio, the way they put the information across. Because if we think early on, as science evolves, early on in the pandemic, we had Jason Leach and Nicola Sturgeon coming on and saying masks weren't, the evidence wasn't there for masks. And of course, as the science evolved, the evidence was there for masks. So early on, you would be, in a public health environment, you'd be saying you've got to be careful what you say, and then that completely changes. Are you not then susceptible to a certain amount of criticism, especially on the free speech, when you're preventing people from saying one thing, and then it becomes the reality a wee bit later on?
I think with that particular example, I think context is key again. I can't remember the specific discussions around that, but if you're accepting that this is a fast-moving situation and things are changing, as long as you're providing that context to an audience, that would presume, that feels like that's the kind of comment that is the kind of context we'd be looking to in that example. Can I come in on just the points around data as well, if I may? I think we all agree of the importance of good data and evidence-based decision-making. That's something we do at Ofcom as well, but as important as good data are the skills to interpret it and understand what's going on. And there is a skills gap, and that's where media literacy comes in. Of the adult population online across the UK, 6% of people believe everything they see, and around a third of people don't question truthfulness or don't understand, don't know things, and just take things as read. And actually, to go back to Mr. Mason's point around fact-checking sites, there's clearly value in having them there, and we linked to them ourselves throughout the pandemic. But if you don't have the skills to understand what they're saying and even get there and get online, they have a limited impact.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, please.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to refer back to my original question back in the previous panel we had. The what are they called? SciBe. Some of the stuff that they had written down, key challenges of communicating public health messages during the pandemic relate to maintaining public knowledge of and trust in quickly changing information, combating misinformation. Underpin the evidence and recommendations of this statement is a critical role of public trust in institutions during a crisis. It is important to bear in mind how to tackle any challenges while maintaining public trust in health authorities and governments. EDS, trust, quality, value, those are the things. So I want to come back to the point I made earlier on. None of what we're talking about matters if the public don't trust what it is that they're getting. Is there... Now, this is now becoming politicised. Right at the start of the pandemic, it wasn't. There was no political arguments. But now it is, and we sit in this chamber, we sit in this committee, and it gets political. We currently have a breach of trust right now in the UK government because of the Prime Minister, and I'm genuinely not trying to make this political. It's about if we have another situation coming forward, because we're not out of the pandemic, there are still things happening, there it could still be another variant. How do we maintain the level of trust that we had at the start of this pandemic, given the situation that we're currently in? Because everything else that we're talking about is utterly irrelevant
if the public don't trust what it is that we're telling them? I'll come to you first.
Well, thank you. And I've been racking my brains to think of a way of answering which quotes a Jam lyric, and I'm sorry if I don't come up with one. To anybody who's listening to this who is in the second hand, they'll be like, what is he talking about? But anyway, I'll see what I can do. I mean, we start by thinking about what is it that supports public confidence in statistics and data. But I think the answers we get to actually have a broader reach. I think they have a wider reach, and I think they can potentially provide some of the answers to the bigger questions that you're asking, which I will say are not really my responsibility, but we're not shy of saying, actually, there's something quite good going on here. We think it can have broader relevance. So what have we learned? We've learned that it's no good just putting the numbers out. If you just put the numbers out, we use the phrase dump the numbers out, you run into problems of potentially confusing people, running into maybe some of the literacy issues that Stefan was mentioning. You also create the risk of other people can then tell their stories and you're not there to rebut them with the correct interpretation. And finally, you lose any benefit of making kind of definitions and what we call metadata in statistics, the way the data compiled available, so other people can pick up the data and use them and create useful insights. And there was a lot of that in the pandemic, sort of armchair epidemiologists doing that. So what do you need to do other than just dump the data out? You need to make the data accessible. You need to make it downloadable. You also need to be very clear on the interpretation that the professional statisticians are putting on it, what they think it means and what they think it doesn't mean. And there are examples where that wasn't done, what it doesn't mean, and that led into some subsequent episodes of misinformation. And then you also pay attention to what we call quality. You pay attention to, the strengths and limitations of the data, and to value. And value is about engaging with an audience, understanding what that audience wants to know and how your statistics and data serve that. So if you pay attention to trustworthiness, you commit to openness and transparency. If you pay attention to explaining quality, and if you pay attention to a conversation around value engagement, you get the kinds of results that we got from the excellent Public Health Scotland dashboard, which did command public confidence. And actually, Tracy Brown's figures about the number of people who are going to government websites and the ONS, I think, are entirely relevant for Scotland as well. So you get this model of just for complete model of TQV. I think that it's quite those principles of openness and transparency, of explanation and of engagement are really powerful beyond communications, data and statistics. I think for health information, for policy choices, they are really good guides. So my answer to your question, what could we do? I'd say pay attention to what we call TQV, trustworthiness, quality and value.
Okay. One of the things that Tracy did say was science fed into the policy was restricted by the questions being asked by the politicians of the scientists. Now, that's maybe one for yourself, Nick, because that whole trust thing, when I hear that, if I'm a conspiracy theorist, I'm thinking, are the politicians only asking the questions that they want the answers to? So is that factually correct, that scientists only answer the questions that politicians put to them in the way a politician puts it?
No, I think we try to give a rounded, objective assessment of the situation. Clearly, there are policy issues for which specific information is wanted, and we try to provide as rounded and as objective evidence as we can. Clearly, once people have it, they may wish to choose to interpret it in a different way. And, we see that with the media a lot, where they will take a statement and they will either project it one way or another. Sometimes, I think, to try and capture the attention and to try and get the readers, to read to buy the newspaper. So it is tricky, and what we've always tried to do, particularly with our statistics, is have a rigour and robustness to them, And if there are errors, we will admit it and we'll change them as quickly as we can. We do that with the information we have. If we find a correction on our material, we will correct it as soon as we can, which is usually within 24 hours once it's been pointed. But trust is a really interesting thing, because once you lose it, it's incredibly difficult to get back. And it's something that I put a lot of effort into, and will try, will not get myself into a position where we're saying things that are counter to what I know is not right or to be wrong. We will give objective information, but as I say, ultimately how that is used or interpreted, we have no control over. And the media is a very good example of that.
Well, that takes me straight on to you, Stephen.
Yes.
Talking about how the messages were put out, how the media was used, I think broadly in this country, television is very trusted. But is there a print media? Not so much. I think there is definitely, you know, on both sides, there are certain papers I won't buy, and there'll be other folk going the other way. In terms of public ownership, is that important for people's trust, to be able to trust the media that they're getting from television?
Public ownership,
public
as in?
Public ownership of
their media.
Of the media, yes.
Yeah. I think you're right to point out that our broadcasting is hugely trusted. When we ask audiences, you know, what the most important value of public service media is, it's accurate and impartial news. That's what they want to see from their broadcasters. And the distinction between broadcasters and, you know, newspapers is that, you know, broadcasters are high reach and high trusted platform. You know, newspapers obviously have been on a downward trajectory in terms of sales for many years now, and as is TV viewing, of course, but to a lesser extent. There's no one thing that's going to stop misinformation, but I think the best counterweight to it is accurate and impartial news. And I think we see that, we have that in this country with our broadcasting, and we see that with the way audiences flock to them at moments of huge importance. We saw that at the start of the pandemic. And even this year as well, we've seen, you know, when, you know, the invasion of Ukraine began, news across our public service broadcasters went up as well. So we have that, and it's something I think we should look to maintain in a public service broadcasting sector.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Gideon.
That's great, thank you. We've got a few more minutes in, Dr. Finn. If I could just ask you one last question. Given all your experience and background, did you ever envisage the enormity and the scale of COVID-19 that hit us in March 2020?
No, I mean, I think it would be fair to say that we were preparing for a pandemic, but we put in place measures that we thought would be reasonably effective at trying to control the spread. So there was a large stockpile of PPE. It was based on flu, which it was there for 12 weeks, which is what we would expect to, which is what we saw with consecutive pandemics. These are very rapidly escalating incidents, and then they will tail off. There were antiviral stockpiles, there were antibiotic stockpiles, there was equipment stockpiled, all ready to be used in the event of a pandemic. We had telephone lines set up, there were call centres, there was an antiviral distribution system, so there was a lot in place. And I didn't expect to see anything like this. It seemed to be almost like a domino effect. Once one country locked down, every other country seemed to feel that they had to do the same. And it's worth noting that Sweden, who didn't lock down, an enormous amount of pressure was put on them by the countries to do the same, which was to lock down. So lockdown was never an anticipated response to a pandemic. We talked about restricting, you know, potentially closing schools. There are various scenarios portrayed, but whole country lockdown was not one of the responses that was actually ever envisaged. So in that sense, it was a surprise. I think that the only other thing to say is that I think over a number of years, public health agencies have struggled because we've seen successive reductions in resources. People think infectious disease is not so much of an issue now. And one of the things that we had to change our thinking was at the early stages to think big and to think bold so that you can actually make a difference at a very early stage. And that was quite a challenge given the mindset that a number of us had been adopting over a number of years. So one of the things that will come out of it is we need to be thinking about future investment and preparedness for a whole number of agencies to be able to communicate, to get the data, to provide the analysis, to inform policy.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Brian Whittle, but we're very short on time, so just...
Yeah, I'll be very, very quick, Dr. Finn. I'm just following on from the convener there. I wonder what you think the impact of SARS and avian flu had in our thinking, given that I think it was avian flu that they suspected that there could be 50,000 deaths from that in the UK, and it turned out to be about 464 or something like that. And I think that stat, did that influence the way in which we approached this particular pandemic?
The avian flu was H5N1, and that was because there was an outbreak identified in Southeast Asia, and everyone was thinking this could be the start of another pandemic because, you know, historically, most pandemics seem to originate in the Far East, Southeast Asia, eastern parts of Russia. So that H5N1, which was around about 2004, certainly raised the profile of pandemic flu thinking. In 2009, where we had H1N1, which often called swine flu, the initial predictions were 1% mortality. But as we got into it, that rapidly dropped to something like 0.01%. Mm. And the number of deaths we saw in the UK and globally were not what was anticipated. And that's actually quite important to bear in mind, because to some extent, that was at the back of people's minds when they're saying, do we declare this to be in a major emergency? Yeah. Based on what happened in 2009, how confident are we? And there was a lot of hesitancy potentially around actually wanting to do it.
Thank
you. Okay, just a couple more minutes. I know Ed and then Jim Fairley.
Well, very briefly, I'm not going to say that, before the pandemic I predicted or anything like that. That would be completely false. But one thing which didn't surprise me in the pandemic was this. I used to go and give presentations to senior government officials across the UK, and I'd have this pitch, which was, don't think of your statistics and data as being an elite sport, just for you as policymakers to come up with wise policies that enable you to run your country as well. Think of them as a public asset. They're collected from people, they're collected from society, they reflect back what society is like. And, you know, I developed quite a, what I hope was quite a sort of an emotional pitch about how important statistics were to kind of civic life. And the eyes would always glaze over. And I think they imagined I was inhabiting some kind of fantasy land where the population was interested in statistics and looking at them every day and using them to guide their choices. And it turned out I wasn't living in a fantasy land. And exactly that's what we saw. And I wasn't surprised by that, because the reason we were saying that was because of our work engaging with particular people on particular issues. We could see this latent thirst for insight that statistics and data could have, not just from experts, but from the population in general. So that element of the pandemic didn't surprise me.
Thank you. Jim Fairley?
I promise I'll be very quick to yourself, Dr. Finn. As a sheep farmer, foot and mouth shut. That's it. Stop moving. If we've got another pandemic coming, what would your advice be?
Well, if we had another pandemic, we'd have to understand exactly what we're dealing with in order to give the appropriate
advice. Let's assume
advice.
It's one that we don't know what its outcomes. We don't know how many people it's going to kill. We go back into that same scenario. What would your advice be on day one?
You're making the assumption we know what the pandemic we're dealing with, that there is a pandemic, and actually making the call that there is a pandemic is actually something that's determined by WHO, and that involves gathering data over a number of weeks in order to do it. So just going back to COVID, I mean, the first indications were an unusual flu in China. We saw the data, the genetic data was published by China in mid-January, and we then used that to say this is similar to SARS-CoV, the original SARS, therefore, from first principles, we try and use that to say it spreads in this way, these are the effects, these are the potential implications, etc. So that would then guide the activities that we'd advise. And at that point, when the SARS-CoV-2 was emerging, the decision was watching and waiting what was happening in China. Because if you recall, back in January, they put the whole of Wuhan into complete lockdown. That was 40 or 50 million people. And the view was that should restrict it to China. So, you know, based on past experience, there was a hesitancy about saying this is a pandemic and then let us take the actions. Of course, pandemics just don't suddenly appear. They always have the first cases. And so it's about being prepared, putting, measures in place at borders, starting to gear up what we're doing for the early detection, and then thinking through what the policy implications might be based on our best understanding of the organism we're dealing with. And, you know, flu was the assumption. It turned out to be something slightly different and with slightly different characteristics, such as spread while people were asymptomatic or without symptoms, which was not factored in a flu pandemic because flu is infectious when you're symptomatic. So understanding the organism is really key to the measures you would take.
Okay.
Great. Thank you very much. I'm very conscious of time. We're 5 minutes over. So I'd like to thank all the witnesses for your evidence this morning and giving us your time. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you regarding this. The committee's next meeting will be on the 9th of June to consider the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 2. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for the meeting to move into our private part. Thank you.